To catch my breath before you stopped. Good morning. Morning to you out there, and a happy new year to everyone. It's a whole lot different today out there than it was, as we know. Last week, Tony and I were just devastated. We had hoped to come, we're going to do it today anyway, to sing Happy Birthday to Jesus. Christmas just doesn't fall on Sunday very often, and we were just so excited about that, but it just was not to be. This is the one Sunday a year, unless we have mechanical difficulties, that we don't have a bulletin. So the bulletin is right here. Same order of worship. We'll share with you what's going on. First of all, Seekers will begin, will resume this Wednesday night in the Parsonage, 6 to 8 p.m. Molly, are you starting next week, the 11th? Is that your... Okay, the W2W, the youth portion of the program, will then resume next Wednesday on the 11th. And we'll be back, hopefully, into good order. We're through with the bad weather now. We don't have to worry about that anymore. Those of you out there watching, it was interesting. Sarah and I were the only ones at the service last week. Sarah was in Columbus, and I was in my studio, my house. And through the miracle of modern technology, we were able to do the worship service. So I'm glad that we can do that. One more announcement. The poinsettias that are in the windows, if anyone would like to have a poinsettia, please feel free to take it home. They're looking great right now. I'm going to give you a poinsettia tip, okay? There's all kinds of complicated things online about how to save a poinsettia from one Christmas to the next. I have saved poinsettias for many, many years. And all I do is just sit them somewhere and just let them do their thing. Water them a little bit. They'll go into shock. They may lose their leaves. They won't be all bloomy and beautiful like they are now. But then in a little while, you'll see little leaves start to come back on and they'll grow. I have one that our son-in-law gave us in 2011, I think. And it is this tall. And it was one that they were throwing out at Lowe's. It was a $2 special. So the idea is if you want to save it, there are six of them. There's one downstairs. Is that right? Seven? Eight? Fight over them. Take them with you. We don't want to try to keep them this year. So that's what's going on. We're glad to have all of you here, all of you worshiping with us here in the new year. We're excited about the things that went on during 2022, especially all around Christmas and the holidays. We did so much. So many things were happening. It was just really exciting, and I personally am looking forward to a new year. And welcome. Sally?
If you please stand, we'll have our invocation. Dear loving God, it is a new year, a new day, a time to reflect on this is the day that the Lord has made. We give grateful thanks to you for the many blessings in our life. Renew our spirits and let them shine, a glowing shine, for with the new year, memories of days past, they weigh heavy on our minds. May those memories mold us, not control us, as we step into a new year. We celebrated Jesus' birth. Now it is time to carry that message of hope, joy, love, and peace into the new year. As we gather today, may we live that message and move into the future, knowing your unconditional love is right there, in good times and in bad times. Your will for all mankind is universal. And as we pray the Lord's Prayer, think about the many people all over the world praying the same prayer of hope, joy, love, and peace. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Amen. let's move forward in our service. And I know you all don't have bulletins with you, so our hymn of praise will be hymn number 159. There's a song in the air. We'll sing verses 1 and 3 of 159.
Where are you? You may be seated. I'm sorry. Come down. Yaya has the children's moment. That's Sally, for those of you. That's Yaya.
Good to see you this morning. I want to talk to you a little bit today about Christmas time. I know Christmas is past. Tell me, you got lots of neat Christmas presents. What was your favorite Christmas present? Did you get a neat dollhouse? You got a dollhouse, and that's pretty special. We still have to put some of the little parts on it, but you got a neat dollhouse, and you got a lot of other neat toys. And everybody out there at home, too, got lots of neat presents. If you didn't get presents under the tree, you got presents from your family, and smiles, and love, and kisses. And you can give smiles and loves and kisses all the time. That's what I was going to talk to you about. You can keep that Christmas spirit, because you're pretty excited at Christmas time, aren't you? Opening up Christmas presents and things. And we love the music, and we love how everything's decorated so pretty. Well, we can carry that feeling in our hearts all year long. Doesn't make any difference if it's at Christmas time or what time of the year it is. It can be all year long. Just remember that you can have a special feeling all year long. Want to bow your head for a word of prayer? Dear God, please be with us today as we did celebrate Christmas a week ago. Today is a new year, and we move forward through the new year. And remember, we can carry that feeling in our hearts all year long, not just at Christmas. Just as we do with Thanksgiving, we carry that feeling with us all year long. In all our prayers, we pray that thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jane Rose was asking me while we were waiting on the front steps this morning how long it's going to be till Christmas is here again. So I didn't have enough fingers. We had to go twice, but we ticked it off and we got around. She said, that's a long time. But as Sally said, we'll keep Christmas in our hearts and keep that wonderful feeling that we have. We'll have, of course, Christmas in July, and July will come around pretty soon, too. So I think we all have enjoyed this holiday. It would have been great to have been able to gather here. As we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer, this is a special hymn that I want to do today because this is the focus of my first sermon for New Year's. Hymn number 346, Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow. 346. And we're going to sing all the verses.
Thank you.
confused through all of that song. I didn't know whether to sing the verse or the refrain. So sometimes I sang the verse, sometimes I sang the refrain. But we got the message, and the message is this: where he leads me, I will follow. We are going to begin our service, prayer time, with singing Happy Birthday. And we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Jesus, because we missed that last week. And you know, on your Facebook page, if you have belated birthdays, you can do that. We'll sing a happy belated birthday to Jesus. Here we go. I don't have my January birthday list. Is there anyone out here that has a birthday that we need to sing to you again?
Barbie does. But she's not here.
Who?
Barbie does.
Barbie does.
Coming up. Is it tomorrow the 2nd?
Yeah. Well, we'll count on you to sing to her. Yeah. I know you can do
it. It's our son Sam's birthday, too. So.
You what?
We have a double birthday at our house. So it's Sam and Barbie tomorrow.
Okay. And then Jack's was on Christmas, wasn't it?
Christmas Eve.
Yeah. Well, a lot of holidays there. Want to have a praise report, I guess. It's a transition report this morning. We have transition in the Wright Law Office this morning. Spike is his term of 20 years as county attorney is ended, and he's transitioning back to private practice, which I'm sure will be interesting. And Sally, his right-hand person in the office, is transitioning back to the Haddix farm out in the country. She's retiring. So we wish the best to both of you, and we give you a little round of applause. For a job well done, and I know it's a transition, but everyone will be fine. You don't have a prayer list, but I have one. We'll go over that. We want to continue to remember Gary Lillard. Cheryl, you have...
I have an update. Gary Lillard actually got a very good report. There was a post on Facebook, and I'm not sure who sees it, but she's had a special list for his conditions for 2 years. 2 years ago, he was told his cancer was inoperable, and he got a report right before Christmas that the cancer is gone. So they had a good Christmas, and she sent out a thing saying, we hope that 2023 is different than our past 2 years. So she wants to thank everyone for the prayers.
Wonderful. How about Alan Jones?
I haven't heard. I know that he was doing an experimental type treatment and it was not working, but I haven't got an update to see if they're doing a new one. The last I heard is it wasn't real good. So we can move Gary to extended, but keep Alan on the prayer list.
Okay. Sally and Bill Dugan, I haven't heard anything from them this week. Is anyone? I'll try to check on that this week. Cammy Perkins, Tony, any changes there?
I don't think it's good, but she's taking it there.
Okay. Janet McGaha, Gayhey. I get Gayhey McGaha. I get it right one of these days. Janet, just outstanding singer in our community choir, and she was facing some challenges that a lot of you know all about. And they wanted to do this surgery and do the treatments prior to the community choir program. But she wanted to sing so badly that she told the doctor that she wanted to wait until after the last program, which was, of course, on the 18th. And so she went in the next Tuesday, the 20th. Jim texted me. She's had some ups and downs. She's not feeling real good right now, but she's at home. Janet, if you all are watching, we wish you the best. If you're not, we still wish you the best. We will continue to hold you and Jim in our prayers. Judy Thompson is Tina's sister, and she is facing some challenges. She wanted me to add her. We want to remember the family of Robert Jewell, good friend of Vicky's, and the family of Arthur Harson has been added too. I think that's everyone that I have on the current list. Does anyone have anyone out here to add or to update? We want to, of course, remember our church in the new year as we get off to hopefully just a continued start right back where we were. I say this often enough, you probably get tired of hearing it, But for a congregation of about 50, that's about what we count, come and go. It's just incredible what you do. It's just incredible that we support one another, we reach out into the community. All of these things are just so wonderful. I hope that in the new year, one of my hopes for the new year is that we can reach out even more and perhaps draw more people into the fellowship of this church. It would just be wonderful if we could do that. So look around, see who you know in the neighborhood, see who you know in the family. Invite them to come, and this is not all we do. So let's just invite them to what goes on in the life and the work of our church. Maybe bow together for a moment of quiet meditation. Father God, as we hear the words of this old favorite hymn, we pray to you, to your Son, to hear, oh, hear us when we pray. We know that you do. We know as we open our hearts, our minds, our mouths, that you know what it is that we need before we ask, that know the direction that we need to go in before we seek that guidance. Whatever it may be. But let another aspect of our prayer be the aspect of praise, to thank you for all that you do for us, for all the doors that you open, for the paths that you guide us on. Sometimes if we start down the wrong one, that you grab us by the scruff of the neck and pull us back. Sometimes in our objection, we think, but come to find out that it is the right thing to do, that we were going in the wrong direction. Here on this first Sunday of the new year, a time when traditionally we come together in the church, families, friends, community, we celebrate the transitions that are going on in our lives, even if there is questions around where we're going next, what we're going to do. But we know that we don't go it alone. We celebrate transitions. We celebrate new hope. There just seems to be something about the new year that offers that hope, that the things of the past will still be there. We will still need to deal with challenges or whatever we may have, with blessings, expand upon them. But here it is, the slate is washed clean. We're hanging up new calendars, putting new desk calendars out. We're talking about the new year and what we want to accomplish. On that journey, O God, we pray, we beseech, we even go so far as to beg you to please be with us on that journey and to open our hearts to listen to what you have to say, to what you want us to do, to where you want us to go. We come into your house today. We give you thanks for the blessings that we have, all of the things that you do for us that we sometimes don't even know. We thank you for the moderation of the weather that just absolutely that crippled the Christmas weekend across much of our country. We pray for those who have suffered extensive damage, who lost loved ones and friends in this storm. We recognize and we are brought to our knees in the face of the power of Mother Nature. We pray that we can come to our knees and ask you for guidance and direction in our lives. We pray this morning that you would be with all of those who we've mentioned on the prayer list, those who have lost loved ones, those who are facing good reports, those who are still fighting health issues. We thank you for all of the things that you do for each of us, and we pray that you can do that for them too. Bless us now as we worship together. Bless us as we share at the table. Bless us as we go our way. For it is in your Son's name that we ask it all. Amen.
Well, we don't have a soloist here today, but I kind of took the week off also, and I didn't get my mind on music until last night. And I was going back and reading what Phil had sent me, and a song came to mind called Gentle Shepherd. And I thought, oh, I don't know yet what songs Tina knows. So I sent her a text kind of late, and I said, I know this is a late hour, but I just wondered if you would be at church. And anyway, I heard back from her this morning. She didn't know the song, and she said she didn't think she was going to be here. But Gentle Shepherd is really what the words to it, or I think go with Phil's theme. And I'm just going to read it. It's a short song. And it says, Gentle Shepherd, come and lead us, for we need you to help us find our way. Gentle Shepherd, come and feed us, for we need your strength from day to day. There's no other that we can turn to. Who can help us face another day? Gentle Shepherd, come and lead us, for we need you to help us find our way. So I was thinking, well, I could play it, but no one knows it. So I thought of another song, and I was going to pull up the singers here that were going to sing last week. And the only one that's here is Spike, and I don't think Spike will do a solo. So we're not going to do that. But if you want to turn in your hymn book to 557, I'm going to play it. Everyone knows the song. It's Just a Closer Walk with Thee. I'm going to pep it up and do it Bob style. But if you want to at least sing it to yourself, I'm going to play a couple verses of it. And I think the words to this song also are very appropriate for today, that we can each ask the Lord to help us live just a little closer with Him.
You to stomping your feet, at least thinking about it, then you did, or close to it. Thank you, Shirley. I could see Bob up there jiving along and singing that right now, too. Wonderful song. Sets the stage. Where He leads me, I will follow. I have two verses of Scripture that I'm going to read this morning. Two verses. Sometimes we know that we can read a long scripture, tells a long story. Other times, there's a lot said in just a very short amount of time. Some of the pithiest things, if that's a good word to use with regard to scripture, in my opinion, come in a short verse or two that focus the attention of where we are. This is half of a verse. This is just half a verse and another verse from the 23rd Psalm. So we say in the biblical studies is verse 2b and 3. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Secondly, this one of my favorite passages in the Advent and the Easter season. This is in the situation where Jesus is praying in the garden, and his disciples he's gone away from them, and he's praying by himself, and he's talking to his Father about what's going to happen and the events of the following days. This is from the 26th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew, one verse, verse 39. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and he prayed, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." And this, I think, is just the most important part of it. "Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Not as I will, not what I would like to do, but what you want me to do. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. All of us in our life journey, one thing to the next depends on what situation we're in. We are either leaders or we're followers. Sometimes we lead, sometimes we follow. It depends on the situation. Depends on what's going on, what you're doing. Is it your job? Are you sitting in an audience in the congregation at a worship service or at a concert? Are you leading cheers at a basketball game? Are you playing on the floor? One thing after another, they break down to it's either leadership or following. And we all find ourselves in those positions. Sometimes there are things that we have volunteered for. There are things that we know that when you teachers stand up in front of your classrooms, you know you're the leader. You're the leader. You're the one who's going to tell the students what they need to do, what they need to hear. If you stand up before the classroom, how long does it take, psychologist here? How long does it take to just stand there in silence before people become very, very, very uncomfortable? It's not long. 15, 20 seconds at the most. If I come up here, walk up here for the sermon, and I stand up here in the pulpit, and I just stand here, look at the ceiling, look at the walls, look at the other. Before long, somebody say, "What's wrong with Phil? Must be something wrong with Pidgey. Go up there, see if he's all right." Because we expect something to happen depending on the situation that is there. Sometimes we're called to be leaders. Sometimes we're called to be followers. There is story after story after story, wonderful stories in the Bible of men and women who were called to leadership positions. And to a person, I can't think of the one that walked up and said, "I'm ready to go. I'd do it. You know, I'm excited about it." They may come to that point, but initially they're saying, "Oh, Lordy, let me find something to hide behind. Let me find a bush that I can get behind. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. There's somebody better." We can tick them off just so quickly that we need to be reminded of them, though. In the Old Testament, there was Moses. Everyone knows what Moses was called to do. He was called to lead the people of Israel out of bondage in Egypt. God found him after he had run away from Egypt because Pharaoh was going to kill him because he had killed an Egyptian who had killed one of his fellow Israelites. A lot of killing going on in those days. He'd gone, he'd found a new life. He was tending sheep for his father-in-law, Jethro. He had married. He had settled down as a shepherd. He thought, "It's going to be good. I don't have to worry about this anymore. I'm going to take care of these sheep. This is what I'm going to do." Lord comes, taps him on the shoulders. "Moses, not quite done yet. I want you to go back to Egypt, and I want you to tell Pharaoh. Tell Pharaoh, the guy you grew up with, the guy who threw you out of Egypt, I want you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Can you imagine how Moses must have felt? How he must have thought, oh my goodness, this is the eminent power, political power, on the face of the earth at this time. And you want me, a lowly shepherd, to go and tell him that? Moses tried everything that he could not to take that position, even to the fact that he wasn't eloquent. He couldn't speak very well. God said, no problem with that. I call you brother-in-law. He can do the talking. You just do. You're my man, though. You do what I ask you and tell Aaron what you need to say. We have Moses. We have Jonah. Great story. We know Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. The Lord said, no, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh. I want you to prophesy to that people because they've really gone bad. Jonah said, nope, not me. Goes down, catches even a boat, ends up in the belly of a whale. Don't worry about the historical facts. Was it a big fish? Was it a shark? Was it a barracuda? What was it? How it happened? It's a story that has the efficacy, the meaning of God's power. God says, I want you to do it. Jonah said, no. The ship crashes. Jonah ends up in the whale. The next thing you know, Jonah spit out on the beach. I think that's a wonderful image. Can you see that whale driving up to the beach, driving up to the beach? I don't think anybody ever drove a whale. Drives up there. Jonah comes out, lands on the beach, and the Lord standing right there. His voice says, hey, Jonah, how about it now? You want to go to Nineveh? Jonah says, where's my ticket? Punch my ticket on the train. Get me a car. Get me a plane. Get me a camel. Get me anything. I'm going to Nineveh. And he went. And he did what the Lord told him, and the people followed him. Then he got mad about that. I'm telling you, strange people, Jonah. He didn't want to do it, but when he did it, it turned out well. On and on, in the New Testament, we have perhaps the most eminent person that caused the New Testament to be there in Jesus Christ. And we just read the verse. Did it sound to you like Jesus was excited about being crucified? It didn't sound to me like that. But what he said to God is what we need to hear. Not what I want to do, but what you want me to do. Not my will be done, but your will be done. And he went on with the plan. And here we are today because of that. What if God had said, okay, I relent. I feel sorry that we ever did this. I feel sorry we ever made this plan. You just go on making furniture and things in your shop. Live out your life normally. And at the end of that time, when Jesus died, Christianity would have died with him. Just as sure as I'm standing here. Then we have the great apostle Paul, who wasn't even an official apostle. He wasn't planning on being a Christian when he was riding down the road and he was going to persecute Christians when God knocks him off the horse. Blinds him, takes him in and says, okay, Paul, this is what I want you to do. The scales are lifted from Paul's eyes. He comes away with a different point of view. You remember that country music song? Too bad Laura isn't here. She knows all those country music songs. Where the guy, he had an attitude adjustment, and he came away with a different point of view. All of these people came away with a different point of view. Now, Jesus is different in some senses because he was a part of making the plan. They all came away with a different point of view. It would be easier just to be a follower. It would be easier to play out the company line. It would be easier to just sit and criticize. It would be easier to sit and clap. It would just be easier to sit. Not this church that I know much about, I've ever heard. But there are a lot of churches that it just seems the best thing in the world, the most fun, is to see how much criticism you can level at what's going on in the church. Wonder how some churches change preachers so fast. Well, they change because as soon as the person, the man or the woman, takes the position, everybody starts to griping and carrying on about what they do, what they don't do, how they dress, what they speak about, so forth and so on. Next thing you know, they're changing it. It's easy to do that. But come up here and stand on this side for a minute. Those of you who have stood up here, even though right now our pews aren't packed, wouldn't matter if they were or they weren't. Our pews weren't packed last week. Sarah was somewhere 5,000 miles away. I was sitting in my little studio that David and Sarah and I had created electronically. I was looking at a horse blanket. That's what I was looking at. A big red horse blanket and a blanked out computer screen. It was me, the horse blanket, and the computer screen. That's all it was. Nobody was there to object. But you feel the presence of others. You feel what's going on. How do we step forward and say, Lord, send me. Here am I. Send me. One of the favorite songs that we sing, that Shirley plays from time to time. She's looking at me now. She said, if I'd have known you were going to do that, I would have played that one. A lot of these songs tell the greatest message, and we have the opportunity to reaffirm who we are. How do you know what you're supposed to do? How do you know? How do you have it confirmed? How do you have that feeling in your heart that says, I need to do this, that, or the other? And you say, how is that going to be confirmed? What do I want to do? Where do I want to go? How do I want to use my talents? We don't want to just ask God to rubber stamp it. You say, God, I'd really like to have a new car. Could you help me out? You know what God's going to say that? Oh, yeah, go down to the bank, get you a loan, buy your car. Watch these commercials on television. Don't you love the one where the woman whistles and the big GM truck comes up out of the snow right after her husband's whistle and there's a dog that came up out of the snow? I love that commercial. That commercial's been on for 5 years. All they do every year is just CGI or whatever they call it. They change the truck. It's just a different truck. She whistles. That's like saying to God, this is what I want. And here it is. No, I don't think that's the way it works. I think we have to formulate what we want in our minds. What would you like to accomplish? Where would you like to go? What would you like to see happen? In your personal life, in your work life, your community life, not just the life of the church, but what do we like to see happen here? What are the goals? We don't just keep dropping back and back and back. We just keep going forward. Sure, I'd like to have the pews full again. I think all churches would. But very few nowadays, after the pandemic, we all turned, many, many, many of us, turned to the electronics. And people said, well, I don't have to go. I don't have to do that. Well, we have a lot that goes on beyond that. What would you like to see happen in the life of the church? What in your life, in your personal life? What are you going to do now that you retired? You know? Plenty. Nothing? Plenty. Yeah. Look at Shirley. When she retired, how long? It hadn't even been a year yet, has it? She's lost weight. She's had a difficult people. Everybody's calling Shirley. Every time you look around, you turn, Shirley's doing this, that, the other. It doesn't seem to work like that you're just going to go sit down somewhere. What do you want to do? You formulate it and you say, God, I have a plan. What do you think about it? It's like planting your garden. I cranked up my planting by the signs column again this week after a month or so off. And all these people writing, oh, we're so glad you're back, glad you didn't die over Christmas and all this kind of stuff, you know. And I said, me too. Now we're starting to plant our gardens. The days are getting longer, aren't they? Can you tell? I mean, heck, we're 2 weeks into winter now. Days are just getting... By the time February comes, we will have 30 more minutes of daylight than we did on January 1st. It's happening. What do you want to plant in your garden? What do you want to do? What are you planning? You know, you don't just go out and say, well, I'll just wait till June. I'll go dig me a hole, throw in a few things, see what comes up. You need to plan. We plan what we want to do. Secondly, we take the plan before God and humbly present it to Him. God, here's my plan. I'd like for you to help me, to give me a feeling, to tweak it, to guide me, to direct me. We're planning to do this. I want to do this in my life. What do we do? Where He leads me. We're saying, God, lead me, and I will follow. Then we pray for guidance. We pray for leadership from God to make the plan a reality. You can have a great plan for a garden. You can plot it out on paper. I'm going to put my onions here and my beans here. I'm going to put my tomatoes there. my corn there. I'm going to put my, in my neighborhood, I'm going to put my deer right here so that they can just, as it comes out of the ground, just eat it right on up. I don't know what kind of problem you all have here with deer, but man, right in practically downtown Frankfort where we live, overlooking the capital of this great state, we have more wild animals there than we did when we lived in the country. We have deer, we have coyotes, we have rabbits, we have squirrels. Now and then we have a wild turkey pass, it's true. And all these things need a little bite to eat, don't they? So they stop by the garden. So you have to say, well, if I'm going to plant this garden, I'm going to have to take care of it. And that's the way it is with whatever your plan is in life. If I'm going to plant it and plant it, I've got to take care of it. I just can't put it out there and expect something not to happen one way or the other. So we have choices. We ask God to provide us the direction, the leadership, the path. When the church service is over today, I want to go downstairs and shake hands and say hi to you. Well, how am I going to do that? I've got a plan. I'm going to stand right here. I'm going to come down this road. I'm going to go out that way. If I went out that side, the world might shatter. Something might happen if I went down that pew. What if I get all excited, and I get up and I just jump from pew to pew to pew? By the time I get back to you, you probably have to call for the EMT to come and pick the old dude up. I think, well, that'll be good. I'll jump up on the pew. I'll go from one to another. Know our plan. What's our plan? Where are we going? Jesus didn't plan to die. Paul didn't plan to be the champion of Christianity. Moses didn't plan to be the leader that would take the people of Israel out of bondage. Gideon, who we didn't mention, didn't plan to lead a great army. Jonah didn't plan to prophesy to the people of Nineveh. But they all did it, and it all worked out well. Why? Because even in their objection, they finally said, turn to God and say, where you lead me, I will follow. May we bow together in prayer. Our Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the music of the day. We thank you for the fellowship of the day. We thank you for these examples from the stories of the great Bible. This book has so much in it that provides us with inspiration. Not things to fear, but things to guide. Things as we see other men and women just like us who struggle. To come to you and to turn to you and to feel your presence. Thank you, O God. Thank you in the old year and in the new. Where you lead us, may we dedicate ourselves to follow. In his name we ask it. Amen. One more time, we're going to sing Joy to the World. You could sing it all the time. Another church I served, we had what we called a singspiration. Got the head of the elders did it, and he'd stand up before the congregation. He'd say, what do you want to sing? Well, there was one guy that always wanted to sing Joy to the World. There was another one who always wanted to sing How Great Thou Art. We finally had to put a hiatus on those that we weren't going to sing them every week. But this is the last week of Christmas. We may sing this again sometime, but let's stand up and sing the first and third verses, only two. It won't strain you at all. 1, 4, 3. 1, 4, 3, Joy to the World. Please be seated.
we come to the time in our service where we gather around the Lord's table. I wanted to point out, I don't know if you can see it at home, but we have lit the Christ candle on the Advent wreath. We didn't get to light it last week. It was Christmas Sunday. And we all got to enjoy Christmas at home, and we viewed it on live stream with Phil at his home in Frankfurt. But we have lit the Christ candle today in honor of Christ, in honor of Jesus' birth. And we want to carry that wonderful feeling with us all year long. As Phil was saying in his message today, there are lots of wonderful songs that we sing at Christmas time. We sing throughout the year, but we had a wonderful song on Christmas, not last Sunday, on Christmas Sunday, but the Sunday before. We call that our Christmas Sunday, where we have our meal downstairs. It's called Walk in the Light, and several came up here and they sang, and it's a wonderful song because we all want to walk in the light all year long and carry that light with us. For Jesus is the light of the world, and we want to remember his great sacrifices when we gather around the Lord's table. As we prepare our hearts and minds for communion, let us pray. Dear God, dear loving God, be with us today and open our eyes as we partake of these emblems. May our eyes and ears and hearts be open to receive these emblems, for they are food for our souls. They are food for our bodies. We do all these things in Jesus' name, and we pray that thy will be done, not our will, but thy will. In Jesus' name, amen. And that night, when Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room, when they were celebrating the Last Supper, he took the bread, and he broke it, and he blessed it, and he passed it among them, saying, "Take, eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you." Let us take the bread of heaven together and remember Jesus. And in like manner, Jesus took the cup, and he passed it among his disciples, saying, "Take, drink, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And remember, as often as you eat the bread and you do drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us take the fruit of the vine together and remember Jesus. Let us pray. Dear loving God, we have heard a wonderful message here today on this new year, the dawn of the new year. We had our dawning last night. Today is our new year. As we move forward into the future, let Jesus be the light of our world. As Jesus walks by our side, remember, we have that eternal flame that is in all of us. In all our prayers, we pray that thy will be done. Not our will, but thy will. In Jesus' name, amen.
We stand for the benediction. Wow.
So, which has been tradition, I guess, since I've been coming anyway, we've put together a little envelope for you. They don't ever let me see what's in it, but I'm sure it's something nice. So, we've also got one for our comrades in the back there, Miss Sarah and Miss Janie, but they're going to have to stay in their positions, and we'll just deliver their cards to them. So, but anyway, thank you for everything you all three of you have done for us this year, and continued service in 2023, and hopefully, and beyond. So, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all three of you from the congregation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Hey, Phil, before you pray, I never have a chance to see people because I'm always up here, but I need Jane, when I get through up here, I need to see Jane Rose, and I was thinking of who was 16 and under. I need to see Miley. And then Eliana's not here, but her dad is, so I need to see Noah. And Dawson's not here, but Molly is, so I need to see Molly when I get through playing, please.
Y'all got that? I'm under 16. I asked Jane Rose today, I said, "How old are you?" She said, "I'm 4. I said, "How old am I?" "Held up my 76, almost 75. She said, "Golly, that's a lot." Thank you very much. This is unnecessary. It is I who should be giving you something for Christmas. Gosh, you're a great good group of people. Sometimes I think, gee, this wears me out, this drive, particularly in the fog today. I thought, man, I don't think I'd blink my eyes twice on the way up here. But then I get here, my heart's filled. It's what God wants us all to do. Now, may we stand for the benediction. Unless Tony has something else to say.
You done?
God, thank you for bringing us here. In just 3 or 4 minutes, the new year is going to be 12 hours old. 12 hours, half a day of the 365. We've chosen to spend part of our first half of the new year, first half of the new first day, in your house. Help us to feel your presence, not just here, but wherever we may go. Thank you. In his name we ask it. Amen.